Good morning. One or two items to draw your attention to. Recently, I was trying to flog an umbrella that somebody left in the church. Today, I have a pair of glasses. They're a bit small for me, so they're no good to me. So there we are, we've got the owner up. Thank you, Sandra. Just to remind folks, there's soup and tray bakes, so lunch will be served in the church hall immediately after the service this morning. Donations, it's to support Christian Aid. We'll similarly have lunch after the service on Communion Sunday, which is the 19th of the month. And on Tuesday 14th, again in the church hall, and was it Saturday the 20-something? I'll intimate that close at the time. That's too far away to think about. But we're going to have a group here from the Iona community or family group who are coming along, and I'm going to give a talk on pilgrimage. Local famous saints. So we'll probably do Lawrence, Drustan, Rule, Stracathro, and who else? Palladius, maybe. Something like that. I'll give some thought to near the time. Anyway, we're encouraging you, everyone, to come along and join with us on that occasion. And again, we'll have lunch afterwards, and all the monies raised will go to Christian Aid. There will be no Bible study this coming Wednesday. I've got to convene a group on behalf of Presbytery in Arbroath regarding a vacancy there. So I'm away on Wednesday. So there's no Bible study this coming Wednesday evening. The next church history group outing, however, will be to Montrose St. Andrew's and Old. That's what it used to be called. It's now been changed. It's now Trinity and Steeple Church, I think. But that's where we're going to gather on Thursday rather than Tuesday. Thursday, the 16th of May, beginning at 11:30. Bring along a packed lunch as usual. The only reason it's not going to be on the Tuesday is because the museum, which I want to visit after we've been to the church, which is a short distance walk, is not open on a Tuesday. So we're going to do the Thursday instead. Our second communion in the year will be in 2 weeks' time, so not next Sunday, but the following Sunday. And I think that's everything. You know, there was a couple of ladies thought they escaped the happy birthday song. And you know, I just can't let it go, really. So I'm thinking, if we could combine Sandra and Sybil, who recently have had important, lovely birthdays and celebrations. So I think it would be appropriate. I'm just... Are we okay with that? I maybe should have said to Lorraine beforehand, but... Very skilled and talented musician, so no problem. We'll sing Happy Birthday. That's
Happy Birthday to you. Happy Birthday to you. Happy Birthday to Sandra and Sybil. Happy Birthday to you.
Hip hip. Congratulations. Sybil must have got word because she's not here. Anyway, well, let us worship God. Let us sing to his praise. It's a lovely hymn, and it's a hymn I'm sure you're familiar with. It's not in our book. It's one of my favorite hymns. Come thou fount of every blessing.
Thank you.
Well, let us come before God in prayer. Let us bow our heads. Lord our God, we come to you, the fount of every blessing, as the beneficiaries of your amazing grace. May we be still and know that you are God. May we come into your presence, enthusiastically anticipating an encounter with you through the ministry of word, praise, and prayer. Anoint us and fill us afresh with your Spirit and enrich our fellowship with you and one another as your family gathered in this place, set apart and special to us. Enable us to hear the voice of our beloved, that we may be better enlightened and equipped to serve him and his kingdom of love. Lord, receive from us our sacrifice of praise and our freewill offerings. Take them and use us productively and purposefully for the good and growth of Christ's church here and elsewhere. Bless all who contribute their time, talents, and treasures to Christ's cause and commission. Lord, we know that you love a cheerful giver and can make us abound spiritually, temporally, and in good works that are done in love. Channel your grace to us and through us in Jesus Christ our Lord. We ask your blessing upon our fellowship team and upon this month's church lunches in support of Christian Aid. Be with us in our time together as we eat and drink. We similarly ask your blessing on Crossreach, Blytheswood, and the other charitable organizations that we regularly support as a congregation. Bless, too, the work of the Church Guild and those that lead the Little Lightbearers. Father, forgive us our sins for Jesus' sake, who died for our sin and who rose triumphantly to make us righteous. Work in us all that is needful to restore the image and likeness of God in us. Make us imitators of Jesus, that we may do your will as revealed in your word. Help us take hold of your promises and walk by faith, hope, and love. Bless our loved ones and all who contribute to the welfare of church and community. Prosper your people and add to their number those who are being saved. Comfort and console the bereaved. Heal and restore to good health those that are sick in mind, body, or spirit. Liberate those who struggle with addictions. Provide for the poor. Shelter the vulnerable. Protect the innocent. Restore decency and dignity to our land. Send forth laborers into your harvest field in Jesus' name, who taught us to say together, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we're continuing today with our theme of the sign of the cross. And this is a well-known painting that I've shown before. This is Matthias Grunewald's Eisenheim altarpiece, the center part of the altarpiece. And it was commissioned by the monastery of St. Anthony in Eisenheim in Germany. And what it teaches us, I think, is it teaches us something, well, more than something, something of real symbolic significance and import to us. You see the Christ, this contorted figure upon the cross, and his body is covered in sores. It's a reminder, it was a reminder to those who saw it, of Christ's empathy and sympathy and his love for those who are suffering in whatever capacity. The monastery of St. Anthony was a hospital, and it specialized in the care of the sick and the dying. And it was they who commissioned this particular work. And it spoke most poignantly to people. I was speaking last week about the significance of the cross in the experience of Alexander Solzhenitsyn while in a Siberian Soviet gulag, or the Polish officer who painted, or who etched rather, a crucifix, a depiction of Christ on the cross in his cell in Auschwitz as he awaited execution. And what it means, what it symbolizes. So I was going to talk about that, right? But then another thought came into my head. This. Do we recognize this figure? Who is it? St. Christopher. You know, once when I was a boy, I used to have a St. Christopher's medallion that I wore, a silver one I wore around. I got it for Christmas one year and wore it until playing, I think, rugby, but it might have been football for Alva Academy. We were playing at Balfron High School. Left it with my clothes in the changing room, and when I came back, it wasn't there. Clearly, somebody was going on a journey, and I don't know what happened. But this wonderful depiction here of Christopher, this great statue that is to be found in Prague, got me thinking. Because while we tend to think of Christopher as a patron saint of travelers, he's really, in the medieval period at least, he was best known for the sign of the cross. That was the story that people told one another when Christopher came up in conversation. Christopher was a large man, huge in stature. And so he's ordinary, he's usually carrying a child or someone, supporting them. And of course, that's our call as Christians. We are called to a ministry of sacrificial care and compassion and consideration of others. The Bible refers to that as love. But this man here, the story goes that before he was a Christian, he was determined to serve the most powerful king in the world. And he went off in search of the most powerful king. And he found himself at a court with a king who was notably influential, who exercised real authority. However, when he saw the king cross himself, when his jester, the court jester, was singing, as whenever the jester mentioned the devil in song, the king crossed himself. And so Christopher asked the monarch, "Why," he said, "why do you cross yourself?" He says, "Because when I hear the devil's name, I am fearful. And so I look to God for protection." And so Christopher said, "Well, I'm not going to serve you. You're clearly not the most powerful king. I'm going to serve the devil." And so he went off in search of Satan. And he was on route, he was on the road, not quite sure where he would go. But isn't it interesting? The evil one knows exactly where we are and meets us. And so he was en route, and he saw this vast army and this formidable leader, warrior, at their head. And the man and the leader asked Christopher, "Where are you going? Who are you?" And he said, "I'm going in search of the devil, because I'm told he's the most powerful and most formidable figure in the world. I'm going to make him my master. I'm going to serve him." And the man, or the figure, the formidable leader, stretched out a hand and he said, "You're looking at him." And so Christopher pledged his loyalty to the devil. And off he went. And they were making their way with this vast army. He had joined the forces of darkness, and they're on their way. And they passed a roadside cross. And the devil trembled when he saw the cross, and he fled for his life. And Christopher was taken aback by this. So the story goes. And he went in search of the devil. He went after him, and he said, "What's happened? Why have you fled? You are formidable." And he told him this. He said, "Once a man named Jesus Christ was nailed to a cross, and when I see his sign, it fills me with terror, and I run from it." And so you can imagine, Christopher says, "Ha ha, you're clearly not the most powerful figure. I'm going to go in search of Jesus Christ." And so he searched for Christ, but Christ truly found him. He found the King of Kings and pledged his love and loyalty to him and loyally served him until his martyrdom and beyond. That's the story of Christopher. It was the sign of the cross that made all the difference, and we're going to continue on that theme, just as it was for Alexander Solzhenitsyn. So it was, as it was for the victims of the plague and other illnesses in the monastery of St. Anthony, as it was for Christopher, so it must be for you and me. We're going to sing once again about that cross on a hill. There is a green hill far away. It's number 380 if you're using the church hymnal. Douglas is going to read for us from the New Testament scriptures.
Good morning. Today's reading is 1 Peter 2:1 to 12, and then 21 to 25. "Therefore, rid yourself of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted the Lord is good. The living stone and a chosen people. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in Scripture it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame." Now to you who believe, this stone is precious, but to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the capstone, and a stone that causes men to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Dear friends, I urge you, as aliens and strangers in the world, to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Moving to verse 21. To this you were called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Amen.
Thank you. We're going to sing once again another well-known hymn, "Take My Life and Let It Be." It's number 502 if you're using the church hymn.
Thank you.
Well, we're not going to turn back to the portion of scripture that Douglas read, although again, it's emphasizing what we are on account of Christ's cross, and hence the importance of the cross in the Christian life. But we're going to turn back to our last week's text, Galatians chapter 6 and verse 14, these words. But far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Well, we simply pick up where we left off last Sunday. Our theme is the sign of the cross, and last week we considered the sign of the cross in terms of God's provision for us and his possession of us, thereby redeemed with the precious blood of a lamb, Christ Jesus our Lord. We also reflected on the cross in terms of our profession of faith and our proclamation of the good news that we are to take to all people everywhere. The cross is a visible and a viable sign. It's a powerful and poignant symbol of the Christian gospel and the faith we are called upon to believe, to uphold, and to promote near and far. If you want, it's a shorthand for the creed, because we're chosen by the Father, redeemed by the Son, and consecrated by the Holy Spirit. Rather than discarding or dismissing the sign, we need to appreciate the sign. Let us appropriate this symbol. Let us not be afraid to adorn our lives and our buildings with the sign and symbol of the cross. Why? Well, consider the following. Firstly, the sign of the cross speaks most powerfully of our participation in the life and love of God in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, writes the Apostle Paul. By Christ's cross, atonement has been made. We are now at one again with the Lord, brought back into, reconciled, and brought back into a right relationship with God. Not that we loved him, but that he loved us and sent his Son, hence the cross, the Father sending the Son into our world to be the propitiation for our sin. And Christ's atoning work is to be received by faith. Nothing in my hands I bring. Simply to your cross I cling. By Christ's cross we have acceptance with God. We have access to the riches of his grace, of his goodness. Every time we see it, we should think of how wonderful our God is, how loving and caring and compassionate he is towards us. How big is the love of God? We see it in the outstretched arms of Jesus on the cross at Calvary. Calvary, hence Christ's cross, is the door, it is the gate to life in all its fullness. He came that we might have life, have it abundantly, and have the guarantee of it everlastingly. By Christ's cross, we have adoption into God's family. Christ's cross is our banner. Go back a couple of weeks, and we were considering the French ambassador de Donteville in the famous painting of Holbein, The Ambassadors. And I was pointing to the family crest on his hat with a skull. Well, Christ's cross is the family crest. Christ and him crucified is our motto. It's through his sacrificial, his saving, sacrificial work, his cross work, that we become the beloved children of God, brought into the royal family, made heirs of God. The sign of the cross also incites God's protection of us in Christ. Except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, Christ's cross is our deliverance. At the cross, our sins are forgiven and forgotten. We find a new start. It's beautifully portrayed for us in Bunyan's allegory of Pilgrim's Progress. When he comes to Calvary and the cross and the burden falls from his back and he's liberated to love and serve God and others. You see, it's at the cross that Satan was decisively defeated. There, the dragon's back was broken. There, the serpent's head was crushed by the seed of the woman, the Lord Jesus Christ. Hence, we understand the story about St. Christopher. By Christ's cross, death itself has been disarmed of its sting because death had no hold of him, but he died and he rose triumphantly on the third day as he promised. Christ's cross, hence, is our defense against the forces of wickedness, of darkness, against temptation. Hence, we ought to keep it in view. I was listening to Rainbow yesterday. The gates of Babylon, it's a warning. Those who get into bed with the devil, you know. But that's what we're warned against. Against pride. Christ's cross is a deterrent. It reminds us of what God has done for us in Jesus. The cost of our liberation. Paid in full, stamped upon his cross. In other words, it's a call to come to God and Jesus. It's a call to sacrificial love. It's a call to humility. It's a call to holiness. It's a call to Christ-likeness. The sign of the cross is a call to practice the Christian faith. The world has been crucified to me and I to the world. The cross reminds us that Christ calls us to discipleship. In other words, it not only communicates our deliverance, but also, you see, we are delivered. If you go back to the Old Testament, the story of the Exodus and how God's people, because it's, again, it's another, it's analogous to the gospel. And hence, we're delivered. We are set free from Pharaoh's hold, from Egypt. But then, of course, we are also, we become disciples that the Egypt is removed from us interiorly because we bring it with us. And so there is this transformation, Christ-likeness. You see, we're called to follow Jesus. We're called to imitate Jesus. We're to bear the divine likeness, the image of Jesus. Christ's cross reminds us of his call, God's call upon our lives to self-denial. Jesus says to us, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Hence it speaks of mortification, a death to self, that we might cultivate the good fruits of the Spirit, love and peace and joy and so on. Faithfulness, kindness, self-control. That's what we're to do, temperance or moderation, whatever. That's the call. We're to put away self-centeredness, egotism, and narcissism. We're to die to self in order that we might truly find ourselves and love God and love others. In other words, the call, the cross is a call to sacrificial service. This is the love that God has for us, that he exemplifies in Jesus. God so loved the world that he gave. Christ gave himself, and hence his cross. It is agape love. And he calls us to do likewise. The cross reminds us of our dependence on God and his grace. We need his grace. We need his guidance. We need his governance throughout our lives and our journey of faith. We need to keep our eyes firmly fixed on Jesus as the author and the finisher of our faith. We need enlightenment. We need enablement. We need empowerment of the Spirit of Christ. And hence it's in Jesus that we receive these things. The sign of the cross invokes God's promises to us in Christ, in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's through Christ's cross that we are recipients of God's blessing and bounty. Hence we read of the riches of his grace. They are lavishly bestowed upon us. They are without limit in Christ Jesus on account of his cross. It is through Christ's cross that we are begotten and we belong. We belong to him, to God as beloved children and one another in fellowship and friendship as family, as the people, as one people. When I am lifted up, said Jesus, I shall draw all people to myself. He was lifted up on the altar of the cross to lift us up to God. It is through Christ's cross that we are born anew and are becoming. We're not the finished article, but we are in the process of becoming. Becoming what? Becoming everything that God intends us to be. To fulfill our potential and purpose as originally intended and revealed. But even better, without the capacity to lose it again. Finally, the sign of the cross is an invitation to spiritual prosperity in Christ. And hence, the benediction, the blessing of God, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. At the end of every service, every Sunday, we say the words, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, that is our Heavenly Father, and the communion, our fellowship of the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with each one of you now and forevermore. And we can say that, I can say that, because of Christ's cross, because of his death and resurrection. Through Christ's cross, we have plentiful provision. Hence, we need to trust him, need to look to him. He sometimes says to us, you do not have because you do not ask. Ask the Father in my name, and I will give to you. He will provide, not always what we want, but he'll give us what we need. Through Christ's cross, we have purposeful and productive service, because we finally understand who we are as children of God. We understand our purpose. So many lost, confused today, in a world that to them makes no sense. No, there's no rhyme or reason. They are but the victims of a cosmic accident. God says differently. He made us in his image for a reason. And he's restoring that. And he calls us to be, to utilize our gifts and graces, to serve us, to ministry. We all have different gifts and graces. Through Christ's cross, we find precious peace. Peace in our souls. Because it's through the cross, the blood of his cross, that he made peace. And oh my, our world so desperately needs to hear that message. We need not only look to the Middle East or to Eastern Europe, but to the machetes and the knives in our cities and our streets in our own country. Christ came that we might own his peace and pursue peace in our world to make it a better place. Let us therefore say, along with the apostle, far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Only then can we truly say, along with Julian of Norwich, all will be well. All manner of things will be well. Well, may the Lord himself add his blessing to these few thoughts. Amen. I'm going to hand over to the choir, and William's chosen a psalm for today. The choir are going to sing a psalm to the tune of the Bays of Harris, which is a wonderful tune. It's my favourite for the 23rd psalm. But so you'll recognise it, but I think he's going to play through the first verse. Do you want the folks to sing, or do you want... And if you want to join in, the words will appear on the screen. Thank you. That was lovely. I once had to present that tune to the 23rd Psalm at a funeral in Portree, Church of Scotland, and the presenter didn't know the tune, but the person, the family had requested it has to be the Beza Harris. So I got up and more like a crow than a canary, right? So I'm presenting the tune, and in the third pew in front of me was Donny Monroe, a run rig. I'd only asked him, you know. Anyway, Andy's going to lead us in prayer.
Let us join together in prayer. God of love, in whom we abide in love, with whom we serve in love, by whom we love one another, we bring our prayers for others, for our world, for our nation, for our neighbors, in solidarity and hope. We pray for those around the world affected by the great challenges of our time, injustice, climate change, conflict and division. May your love overcome fear and distrust, nurturing partnerships of hospitality and welcome, seeking to build a world of peace and hope, of sustainability and harmony. We pray for communities ravaged by injustice, economic and social, that the work of those promoting justice for all would bear fruit, bringing new hope, that all might sing a new song to the Lord and rejoice together. We pray for leaders, those given responsibility to make decisions on our behalf, and councils and parliaments, boards and trusts, that decisions would be made through the lens of love and care, compassion and thoughtfulness, seeking the benefit of all, not just the few. We pray for your church in parishes and presbyteries, that all would seek to live out their faith with authenticity and grace, letting the love of God, expressed in kindness and action, be our witness without fear or worry. We pray for families whose lives have been overturned by conflict, seeking refuge and asylum, that they would find welcome, support, and a new start. By poverty, seeking to feed and warm their families, that they would retain their dignity. By ill health, seeking healing and restoration amidst an overstretched health system. We pray, God of love, in one breath, lamenting situations that seem out of our control, and with the next breath, in joyful hope for you lead us, a resurrection people into the future, abiding in your love. May we, in whatever way we can, inspired by your love for us, be your hands and your feet, transforming the world about us. One act of faithful service at a time. Amen.
Thank you. We're going to conclude our time of worship by singing a well-known old hymn, kind of gospel hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
Let us conclude. And now as we leave this place of worship, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with each one of you, now and forevermore.